really noisy back there. I hold him for a moment and then gathered up some of the documents for scrutiny. I have heard many of the excuses that troopers think up in an attempt to confuse the NCOs, confuse being a nice word. I accepted his word and warned him not to be a nuisance to the officers, nor occupy the compartment serviced by the officers' desire to occupy it. During the opening days of camp, I mentioned to the officer commanding this incident, stating that Jos displayed initiative, was obviously intelligent, and showed potential to one day becoming an officer. The sergeant major is not just a big moustache with a loud voice. He is constantly interacting with his troops, learning their strengths and their weaknesses, and all of the other characteristics that affect men in the heat of battle. We strive to develop dedicated, proud soldiers who are prepared to die for their country.
Please take up your ukulele and join in singing the Lord's My Shepherd.
Thank you.
Simon Peter said, "I'm going fishing." They replied, "We'll come with you." They went out and got into the boat, but caught nothing that night. When it was already light, there stood Jesus on the shore, though the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. Jesus called out, "Haven't you caught anything, friends?" And when they answered, "No," he said, "Throw the net out to starboard and you'll find something." So they threw the net out and could not haul it in because of the quantity of fish. The disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." At these words, "It is the Lord," Simon Peter tied his outer garment round him, for he had nothing on, and jumped into the water. The other disciples came on in the boat, towing the net with the fish. They were only about 100 yards from the land. As soon as they came ashore, they saw that there was some bread there, and a charcoal fire with fish cooking on it. Jesus said, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." Simon Peter went aboard and dragged the net ashore, full of big fish, 153 of them. And in spite of there being so many, the net was not broken. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples was bold enough to ask, "Who are you?" They knew quite well it was the Lord. Jesus then stepped forward, took the bread, and gave it to them, and the same with the fish. This was the third time that Jesus revealed himself to the disciples after rising from the dead. When they had eaten, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be seated. If you wish to remove your jackets, you're welcome to do so. Feel at ease here. When I didn't meet Jos, so I asked some questions about him. And when I asked the question, the first answer I got, they said, when I asked what was he interested in, "Tell me about him," they said, "Rugby." And then the second sentence was, "Rugby." So I thought, okay, tell me more. And there was more. It was good to hear there's more that come. But I always like to link what we have to say in a service like this to the scriptures. But I knew that Rugby isn't to be found in the scriptures. But I do know that Rugby has Christian spiritual origins. And I'm sure he knew that because as a journalist who was so full of Rugby, I'm sure he did his reading around So he began his reforms in the school, developing the spiritual side, hoping that would lead to a more robust moral character. And part of the process of bringing about change in the school was to also stop the wild sporting behavior, trying to codify sport, bringing guys into line and play a decent sport. And so he began to teach them about rugby. Now, I don't know if I'm historically correct, that's a bit the origin of rugby, but anyway, certainly had a powerful impact. And I say these things because I hear not just about rugby when it comes to Jos, but also that he had a spiritual side to him. And I understand that he got a spiritual side through participating in the church here and elsewhere. When I came with this, I didn't meet him here, because I only came a few years ago. But I heard that there was a minister of hospitality, so he would be welcoming people coming to the church. And he was involved in some other activities, but with the youth and the Father Danker in Korea, there was a good influence. Father Danker, for those who don't know, was a very, very good man, and he had great influence over thousands of youth, I think, in his day. So he was involved in the youth work kind of thing. And then as I was listening to these stories about him, I gathered that, as you said in your eulogy or tribute, Mark, that he was known for his love. Love is so important, and that sort of triggered that thought about the reading today from the first letter of St. John, the beloved disciple, the one who rested his head on the chest of Jesus at the Last Supper. He wrote those amazing, those beautiful words that whoever lives in love lives in God, and God lives in him. Whoever loves knows God. Love and relationship with God are very interlinked, because God is love, says John in that letter. So, anyway, to repeat myself, or to repeat John, anybody who lives in love and shows love to others is a person who's close to God. They may not even know that. There are probably more people close to God than we would know or really believe. And that, from what I gather, was expressed in ways of great concern and charity towards others, so that because of his interest in rugby, he wanted to, I'm telling you things, you should be telling me these things, but anyway, I get to stature. But his concern about, maybe not everybody knows, was helping young adults who were interested in rugby to find a place to stay in starting out in rugby and helping them to get a job. These kinds of things are very, very good and so much needed in our day to day. There are so many people out there on the streets. We need people to bring them in the spirit of Dr. Thomas Arnold as well, to try and focus people and get them to learn how to live a good and wholesome life. Dr. Thomas Arnold of that school way back, he encouraged people to develop a strength of character and to be bold and to be courageous, and even encouraged him to go out there as missionaries, and some went as far as the Pacific Islands. So some said, that's where these Pacific Islanders not only get the good rugby from, the powerful rugby, but also the spiritual character, because a lot of family in New Zealand immigrated from here. I've seen some of those guys close up, huge guys, eh? And very enthusiastic about their rugby. And they're not shy in front of a stadium of people to go down and to kneel and to pray. They're not shy to sing hymns. Apparently before their training practices, they would sing hymns. And I read that they knew all the hymns of the Methodist hymnal off by heart. So they would sing, and then they would pray, and then they would practice, and they would speak. And so to bring together these elements, it was very, very good. The wholesomeness of healthy, energetic sports, strength of character, and then expressing it on the sporting field, and then in the moral and the Christian life. So those are good things to hear. Another thing that I heard about him was that he liked swimming. He loved swimming, he was a very good swimmer, he swam for his school, and speak, so maybe this person will recognize. The person who wrote, "I have no doubt that his Catholic upbringing and beliefs carried him when he felt weighed down and helped him to celebrate when he succeeded. So dark nights, they come our way, but we must never forget that the dawn is near, that the dawn is with us in Christ. But there's much more than a miraculous catch awaiting us. It would be nice for those who are fishermen to come home with a big haul, but normally like that. But the prophet Isaiah described the joys of heaven, as you heard in the first reading, the eternal banquet of rich food and fine wines. Well, that's a rather inadequate description, but how else would you describe the joys of heaven for people who haven't been there, and especially for poor people, hungry, thirsty, half naked, those people in Jesus' day, absolute poverty. But perhaps we get a better image, not really an image, but an expression of it through St. Paul in his letter to the Corinthians, when he said, "Eye has not seen, nor has ear heard, nor can the human mind imagine all that God has prepared for those who love him." That sounds potentially far better than an eternal banquet. Whatever your image might be of heaven is not particularly important, whether it's a breakfast on a lakeshore or an eternal banquet. What is important is the desire and the longing for Jesus. All of us should develop this longing. Of course, it's possible. There are ways to do that. But how do we reach Jesus? We don't see him visibly. Well, we know that finally, ultimately, we will have to leave the security of this life, right? We'll have to let go one day. Let go of the nets, the security of our life. Step out of the boat, so to say, bravely. We heard that when John saw Jesus on the shore, he said, "It is the Lord." And then Peter jumped out of the boat and he waded to the shore. Imagine the joy that filled their hearts that morning. And one day, we hope to experience that same joy as we meet our Savior face to face. We can't stay here forever. The closing hymn that we're going to sing today is, "Lord, by the seas, call me onward. Hope eternal for hearts that are searching. And love will bind us as friends forever. With love, you looked in my eyes, Lord. Smiling gently, you called me by name. And I left my boat by the lakeside. And now with you, I will seek other shores, eternal shores." So, yes, other seas call us onward. The boat, which could be seen as a symbol of the church, can take us only so far, close to the shore of heaven. Then, like Peter and like Jos, one by one we have to make a final act of faith. We have to leave the boat. We have to jump into the water, so to say. But it's not hard, it's not far. We have to cover that, figuratively speaking, cover that last stretch to the shore on our own. And it's not a deserted shore, as we know. It takes courage to make that final leap or step, but there's nothing to fear. We have the church, the boat, the community of faith to carry us right behind us, church is right behind us, and then one by one we disembark, we could say. It is the Lord waiting for us. So Jesus, the light of the world, welcomed his beloved friends on the lake shore that early morning, and is also preparing to welcome each one of us. We trust that he's welcoming Jos. Looking forward to taking each one of us by hand and leading us to the Father. Well, there's no need to be afraid, provided that we have given our lives to Jesus. If we live in love as well, and we love the Lord our God with all our hearts, minds, and soul, and strength, we need not be afraid. We know that we may not be perfect. We are not perfect. The apostles have been inconsistent in their discipleship, right? They were filled with remorse. They repented of their sins, and they sought the Lord Jesus. Jesus forgave them for their abandonment, for their denial, for their lack of faithful love, and there on the shore he invites them to a fellowship meal, a meal of reconciliation, a meal of peace on the lake shore. All that Jesus wanted to know from Peter was, "Do you love me? Do you really love me?" Well, Jos was at home in the water, so he could jump over, and he could cover the last stream.
long duration, we shall meet again in heaven. We shall together enjoy eternal happiness, praising God with all the energy of our souls and extolling his mercy forever as we share in the joys of eternity. He takes from us that life which he gives us for a time, for no other purpose than to restore it to us, freed of all care and anxiety, and to endow us with those benefits which have been the object of our hopes. It is my earnest hope that you and all my family will regard my death as a joyful gift of God, and that you will give me your blessing as I cross towards that shore where all my hopes are centered. Unquote. There is Saint Aloysius Gonzaga. So may the Lord strengthen our hope, our confidence, our faith. faith in